Hello and welcome to Policy Watch. We've had an eventful 2013 with some good news and some bad news. Let's break down the economy and its components a little bit and understand each of them and also what we can take forward to 2014 in terms of lessons learned so that perhaps we don't make those mistakes again. Joining me to do that is CRISIL Chief Economist D.K. Joshi. Thank you very much for speaking with us, Mr. Joshi. So before I come to understanding GDP, the components of income and expenditure and where perhaps we've slowed down and where not, what's the feeling like? I mean, if I may ask a very general question, what has it been like to live through 2013 and come to the end of the year and look at our own wallets, our bank accounts, our ability to have bought something or not bought something?
Well, I think it's as far as the summary indicator of the economy is concerned, which people say, I mean, often use GDP as indicating the overall performance of the economy. I think that I would say this is again one of the years which you would like to forget, because the last year was bad. We had 5% growth, and over 5% growth we are struggling to get even 5%. 5% actually today has become aspirational. It's the things are so bad. I mean, I think as far as the economy is concerned, particularly for the middle class, I think this has been a very tough year because the income opportunities have narrowed quite a bit, but the expenditures have risen. What I mean is, when GDP slows down, I think it reflects on people's incomes somewhere, and particularly I think it's getting reflected on the income of households, because if you look at the private consumption expenditure, that has slowed down very sharply. I think it used to be around 8% per annum for a couple of years, and now it actually fell to 1.6%.
So you're saying, so middle class has been affected.
Absolutely.
What about the poorer sections of society?
I think poorer sections of the society spend more on food, and since inflation is primarily food driven, I think they probably paying a more inflation tax than anybody else. I mean, so they are getting impacted even more. They were partly hedged in the last few years because rural wages and even urban wages for casual labors had risen very fast. I think they also slowed down. So obviously, I think this year, both employment generating, or actually there could have been layoffs also in some of the sectors. So and what happens typically in a year when you face high inflation, your ability to you spend necessities you can't cut, and the discretionary spending you start cutting. And I think with the income slowing down, then you cut down the discretionary spending even further. And that is why the performance is so bad for automobile sales and many other durable goods that you
have. So, but are the poor affected equally, and the poor to the extent that some of those poor, or rather many of those poor, come from the agriculture sector, which employs more than half the country's population?
Well, actually, even if you look at the agriculture sector, the rural income is far more than the agriculture income. I think rural folks are depending on off-farm activities much more than on-farm activities.
And can you give us some numbers here? At least,
well, I think it's anecdotal. I mean, in the sense that there were some studies conducted a few years back which pointed that a certain percentage of the income was coming from non-farm. One way to look at it, this would be that agriculture has been growing at 3% per annum, but the rural income has been growing at much faster, maybe double than that. I think that data is available sometimes from the NSSO, and I think I'm using that data to convey this, that the rural income has risen much faster than the agriculture income.
But agriculture, we've had good news. I mean, before I come back to the GDP part.
Absolutely. I think the agriculture, we have definitely had good news. And I think that is why, if you look at the sectors which were related more to agriculture, let's say tractors or two-wheelers, which have a higher penetration in rural areas, they have done much better than the other sectors like cars or commercial vehicles, which actually are linked to the economic cycle much more. They are in deep trouble right now.
So we'll try and understand where this all balances out shortly. But let's come back to GDP now, and let's look at the country as a whole. GDP, is typically defined as private consumption, government consumption, investment, exports, and private demand. So which are the components that have done well and which have not in the last year?
Well, I think if you look at all the three components, I mean, whether it is government consumption or private consumption or it is private investment, I think overall investment has also slowed down. But within that, private investment or private corporate investment, to be precise, has slowed down much sharply. I think all the anecdotal evidence, or by talking to corporates, the information that we get shows that private corporate investment has been hit. Actually, if you look at the headline numbers, it has fallen from somewhere around 17% of GDP in 2007-8 to around 10.5% right now. So there has been a sharp deceleration in the fastest growing component of investment during 2004 to 2008, and that is very, very sluggish.
But the absolute numbers would still be high because your GDP aggregate is higher than what it was in 2007.
That's true, but I think that doesn't matter. What matters is how the increment. GDP is what income generated every year, so I think that won't get a kick. I think the most disappointing part has been a very sharp decline in private household consumption, because that is close to 60% of GDP, and that's the bulwark of overall GDP, so to say. And that has slowed down very, very sharply this year, and it has slowed down because of economy income slowing down. It has slowed down also because of inflation. I think there are various factors why private household consumption expenditure has slowed down.
So when you say economy slowing down and inflation, what could typically affect a household more, or what could you think has affected a household more in the last year?
I think it's both. I think both. One eats into your purchasing power, and second reduces your overall income in any case. So both combined, both are acting in a way to pull your spending down.
So that's the actual number, right? What about the propensity to spend? Is that something that's also been affected? And obviously the next question could be, if it reverses, then would people spend more?
Well, I think, propensity to spend has been affected because in an environment when you're not sure of your incomes, I think you cut down. It's typical. It's very well understood that you cut down on your spending, you actually postpone your consumption decisions.
But does the whole economy work like that? For instance, the agricultural economy, this is just a question, arguably is used to fluctuations in income at all points of time. A typical middle class household riding on the economic boom of the last decade perhaps is seeing it for the first time.
That's right.
Right? So how does that...
Agriculture is different. So that is why agriculture can move in a different direction with respect to this year, if you look at, whenever we get the balance sheet, the rural part of the economy would be much healthier than the urban part, because agriculture did well. So you got that additional lift to rural income, which because of the kindness of God, you got good monsoons. And it's not fully played out as yet, because the good harvest is yet to get reflected in low food inflation. I think so. We'll see it play out in the next couple of months. So that's why the second half of the year will look slightly better than the first half. I think the third, so we've talked about consumption, we've talked about investment, both of are in a bad position. Typically what happens is government
makes up.
But I think only if they run good fiscal balances, and our fiscal balances are extremely stretched. So that is why if you have a very stiff target of fiscal deficit at 4.8% of GDP for which is set for 2013-14, then in order to meet that target, you will have to cut down on expenditure, because you cannot raise revenues in a slowing economy. When corporate profits are are slowing, how will the tax collections go up? It's very, very obvious. So I think the crunch again is coming from the government side also. So there seems to be all the drivers are sputtering right now, and the only kick to growth, which came, I think the data that was released in the last quarter showed that the kick came from the external demand, because the rupee had depreciated and globally
exports have gone up
and imports haven't increased, because imports are also reducing because your economy is slowing. You require less capital goods, you require less consumption goods. All that is getting reflected. So overall economy therefore is actually getting hit from all sides. The only savior from the expenditure side or the demand side seems to be exports this year.
Okay. So on the other side, on supply side, you have agricultural, industry and services, right? So we've touched upon agriculture, which we've said has had good growth. Industry and services, or industry equals manufacturing and then services.
Well,
what's happened there?
Well, actually, industry has painted a very, very grim picture. Industry has three components. It has manufacturing, it has electricity, and it also has construction in it. Now, if you look at construction, has slowed down, but it's not collapsed. But if you look at mining, which is one component, mining, electricity, etc., mining component has been on a downward spiral for some time and has underperformed very significantly. So that is one worry. But I think from the manufacturing side, which is a bulwark of overall industry, I think 60-70% of the industry is composed of manufacturing. I think that has very significantly underperformed this year, and it has been underperforming over the last couple of years.
When you say underperform, you mean?
Underperform means manufacturing has been generally growing at the same rate as GDP. But I think this year you'll hardly get 1% growth in manufacturing, whereas your overall GDP growth will be around 5%.
And so, how would this contrast with, let's say, a China or a developed
Well, China, country. I think...
Maybe not a developed country, but a China.
Well, China, I think manufacturing, they would treat 6-7% as a severe slowdown in manufacturing. Okay. I think China has a large part of economy is manufacturing, 40%. In India, it is about 16%. But I think manufacturing sector is very critical. Again, coming to your linking it to your consumption part also, because manufacturing is very labor intensive, manufacturing and construction activity. And when manufacturing slows down, I think it will not generate enough jobs. So right. It's very clear. And it's manufacturing anyway is suffering from long-term structural issues, which is it has labor laws which are very stifling.
And we haven't seen much fresh investment come in any case because of others.
Absolutely. Manufacturing investment started declining in 2011-12 itself. I think that was the downward spiral. So there are two ways to look at it. One is that from a medium-term perspective, your growth potential or your long-term growth trajectory, medium-term growth trajectory has come down. And then on that also, we are on a cyclical downturn. So we are not even in that trajectory. So it's a tough period for.
Right. So services was supposed to make up for these gaps. So how has services performed in the last?
I think services, if you look at it in parts, there's one part of services which is linked to the external economy, which is IT, ITS, etc., pharmaceuticals. I think the pharmaceutical is manufacturing. Sorry, but IT, ITS is
gems and jewelry.
Gems and jewelry also comes under manufacturing. Okay. So I think it's the IT, ITS in services. And that has done reasonably well. You look at the balance sheet of the big IT, ITS firms. Their profit margins have improved. Clearly a benefit of currency depreciation. But the other services are linked to the domestic economy. I think if manufacturing industry is not doing well, what will the services cater to? And manufacturing activity itself has become more service-oriented. I mean, it's become more service-intensive. So manufacturing or industrial slowdown is also dampening the service sector.
Are the numbers reflecting that already?
Yeah, they are. I mean, service sector grew at 5.9%. And I think within services, what comes is the government services also. I think that has also been a very big dampener. I think...
can you give us an example?
I think because government services, government consumption is here in this side of, when you look at from the supply side, it gets reflected in the service sector. Public, there's a segment called public administration and defense. So I think whatever government spends, I think it gets reflected in... so what I mean by that is in the last few years, we saw some kick from pay commission hike, etc. All that has waned off, and government's ability to spend more on the economy, on social services, etc., I think has definitely been
constrained. And we are seeing that already. The finance minister has been writing to various.
It is visible
ministries.
In the data very clearly that government's ability to push growth has come down significantly, and it will remain weak because in the existing system where you have to control your fiscal deficit, you have no option but to cut your expenditure.
Right, and we'll talk a little bit about what could kick it back in 2014, but we'll also talk about the other important thing, which is the external side, right? We saw the big rupee shock, and really sent the whole country into a tizzy, and we reacted quite emotionally as a matter of fact. But we'll talk about that after a break. Stay with us, you're watching Policy Watch. Hello and welcome back to Policy Watch. A little while ago, we touched upon some of the components of the Indian economy, particularly to do with income and growth and GDP and the breakdown of it. It's not looking very good, but we also looked at some of the positive sides, particularly agriculture. Let's now focus on the big shock that hit India in 2013, and that was the rupee, which created a lot of firestorm, so to speak. My guest continues to be D.K. Joshi, principal economist at CRISIL. Mr. Joshi, so we were all consumed and inflamed by what happened to the rupee. And obviously, it's not just an economic issue, but it's also an emotional issue as we see the rupee sinking and the dollar rising against it. Why did this happen and what are the lessons?
Well, I think, first of all, I think you said, I mean, we have a tendency to believe that strengthening rupee means a stronger economy. Well, I think it's not muscular strength. I mean, so a weak rupee can also make an economy stronger at times. But I think here, now coming back to your moot question, I mean, why this happened? I think this is not a sudden development. It had been building over last few years. Let me take you through what happened since the Lehman crisis. Let's split it into two parts. One is what happens to the rupee depends on demand and supply for dollars, and it also depends on how vulnerable you are and what is the quantum of shock. By vulnerability, I mean how susceptible you are to a hit from the global side, and that is measured by current account deficit. Current account deficit, in simple words, means how much financing you require from other rest of the world to match your savings and investment. There's a gap between investment and savings, and that has to be met by foreign savings. And if the more you depend on foreign savings, the more vulnerable you become, because if there is a crunch on that part, then the supply of dollars will obviously take a hit in the economy. I think what happened since the Lehman crisis, if you look at the vulnerability aspect, measured through current account deficit, CAD at that time was about 2% of GDP. Massive shock hit us. I think world economy went down for the first time since the Second World War. Massive, massive shock. So obviously rupee did take a plunge because there was a huge confidence loss. People pulled their money out of the country. The stock markets plunged. All that happened. So it was understandable rupee plunging. But if you look at 18 months after that, rupee actually started strengthening because the economy was getting back.
And you had a new governor who came.
Economy was getting back into the track. And rupee strengthened for 18 months after the Lehman shock. But what was happening underlying was that the current account deficit kept rising, partly because we were importing a lot of gold. But eventually it is a mismatch. I think you have too much demand in the system. There are many aspects of ways of looking at it, but one way to look at it is that your gold demand was rising, which we talked about earlier. High inflation creates more demand for gold. And also, I think there was a mining ban, so you were importing more raw iron ore, coal, etc. So I think that was also getting reflected.
Did the coal and iron ore import versus export alone create a substantial impact on the figures?
No, it did not create a substantial. The substantial impact was created by gold. But I think this is incremental. I mean, what you were exporting, iron ore, you started importing. So obviously, it changes the equation. So now, the CAD as a percentage of GDP kept rising, and it touched about 5% of GDP. That was the buildup. And I think the latest data on CAD is around 1.2% of GDP, but before that it was at 5%. Now, if you have such high vulnerability that any external shock can have a impact on you, even a smaller shock. So the shock that hit us in the month of July, August was speculation that the Federal Reserve is going to cut back on its spending, the quantitative easing program. Now, when you require foreign funding, then global risk appetite, global liquidity matters, because if they are hurt, then the money will not come here. Actually, there will be a home bias and people will pull out of India. And something of that sort happened during that time, and we had almost had a literally run on the currency, and rupee weakened very sharply.
So when you say home bias in this case, you mean the
Americans or the foreigners taking their money back to their home because of the rising risks. So now, if you compare it with the Lehman period, the shock there we had massive shock, but the vulnerability was still low. But now we had huge vulnerability, so even a mere speculation on quantitative easing was enough to cause a massive shock to the currency, and rupee actually started depreciating, and people were forecasting all kind of wild numbers going up to 70-75 and so on and so forth. But after that, I think that's the primary reason that you had high vulnerability, and
this vulnerability is also something that we have created, we as Indians, by buying a lot of gold, which of course is linked to our own sense of insecurity and so on.
Yeah, it is linked to high inflation. There's no other saving that has generated positive returns. So I mean, why should people not? I mean, when central banks are buying gold. By the way, China has become the world's largest consumer of gold. I think last week. So I think the question there is, if you have high vulnerability, to put it in global context, India was not alone. I mean, there's a country of which fragile five. Right. I mean, which includes Indonesia, Turkey, Brazil, etc. I think all these countries had their currencies plunging. I mean, and we were part of that, and we suffered quite a bit. But after that, I think, let me say that we've been quite judicious. Though the way we brought the current account deficit down is not very prudent, in the sense that you put controls on gold and so on and so forth, which you'll have to release at some point in time, and then CAD might again go up. But the point is, you brought the CAD down, you reduced your vulnerability, And at the same time, what you've done is the central bank has been very prudent in collecting dollar reserves. I mean, either through FCNRB or NRI bonds, that's whatever it is. I mean, they've got. So that is why when actually Federal Reserve started the tapering, announced it last week, the currency has still stayed quite stable. So the shock is actually higher than what it was during that time, because this is actual tapering.
This is the real thing, yeah.
That was just mere speculation. So that is where how the vulnerability picture comes in. So you're less vulnerable. That is why you are able to withstand the shock much better.
Right. So on the external front, this was the shock that we encountered, endured. And now things seem to have settled down, considering that the easing that we was speculated all the time has actually happened.
That's right.
And it doesn't seem to have really impacted the rupee or the markets and so on. So what are the other external factors that we have to consider when we try and, you know, draw a picture of what happened in the economy in 2013, which might hold lessons for 2014?
Well, I think one factor was when we were looking at...
And that could include global trade. I mean, for instance, clearly economies, let's say the UK, the US or the EU for that matter, have all turned around, picked up, and they're doing much better than ever before. Does that
but
impact?
I think as far as the European Europe is concerned, Europe will still, I think 2013 would be a recession year, but they have started looking up, there's no doubt about that, but they have a long way, they have long catch up to do, which will take a long time. If you look at Japan, I think, which is, should not be forgotten, because it's within the among the large four large countries, I think Japan has experimented with a huge amount of policy thrust to push growth up, and they have partly succeeded. Part of it we'll come to see, but I think there's been some positive vibes from Japan. Japanese stock markets picked up. I think the disappointment and optimism both have been from the US economy. When we began the year, I think we were expecting around 3% GDP growth in US, because private sector started becoming more vibrant. There, I think their growth slowdown, or the government shutdown, or what, or the fiscal fiscal break that the government put in, I think that was a result of the inaction, policy inaction on their part, and actually that trimmed off quite a few percentage points of GDP.
Right.
And so I think if US doesn't grow at grows at half the rate of 1.5% and not 3%, then obviously we still export quite a bit to US. So our exports do take some beating. I think the point is, and then China also saw its own turmoil and its growth has perceptibly slowed down and is likely to remain at 7-7.5% for next couple of years, unlike 10-11% that it saw.
So how is this all balancing out? I mean, let's come back to where we started. We said that this was a tough year for most people in this country. Whether you were poor or middle class, you were affected. If you were poor, inflation affected you more because it's a tax on your income. If you were middle class, you actually saw some of your aspirational items slipping beyond your grasp, and maybe even more than aspirational. From the government itself has been forced to cut back on expenditure, and the government is seeing less income. Services has taken a hit because manufacturing has taken a hit, and manufacturing, of course, as you said, is only grown 1%.
Yeah.
So investment is low, and private investment is now 10% compared to 17% of GDP. Yeah. And that now all this has to come back in some ways, right? So the question now is, where does this all balance out as we step into 2014? And what's the good news and what's the not so good news?
I think the good news is that the government reform machinery has started moving. I think if you look at the policy actions, whether it is FDI in retail, which was, I think, more symptomatic, or I think it had a sentimental effect on the economy, or it is land acquisition bill, or you say the ban on the mining getting lifted. I think all these are positive steps. Even the diesel deregulation reform that the government did, I think these are all positive steps, but they don't they cannot push the growth up. I think the innards that need to be corrected, I think one of them is mining. I think if you there is some good news, but it needs to be pushed up so that at least you, you at least whatever is beneath the ground,
mining, construction, electricity.
Yeah, I think that will mining is I think is something that requires a push, and that can make the outlook for next year much better. I think the second is, I think the global economy, US economy, is expected to do better, and they are all bottoming out as we talk. Most of the economies will particularly the western part of the world will do better, so that should provide a kick to our exports to some extent, I think. So that is the positive side. But I think
how much could exports look better by, or how much could they go up by if conditions were to improve?
I think what is happening over the one of the fastest growing components of India's exports have been petroleum exports, mm-hmm. and there we haven't seen enough capacity expansion over the last mm-hmm. couple of years. So they are, that part of the exports is slowing down. Mm-hmm. The non-petroleum parts will get some kick. So overall, the performance may be like this year, right. but I think what you have done is good global growth would mean that the downside to mm-hmm. export growth has been capped. I mean, okay. let me put it this way. Right. Otherwise, you would have suffered because petroleum has, as I said, has exports have been slowing down quite significantly.
Right. So let's come back to what's things going to look like in 2014. What else?
Well, I think 2014, my sense is that we'll see a lift from these levels because mm-hmm. we are perched at the bottom. Mm-hmm. And there has been positive news on two fronts, mm-hmm. which if it picks up momentum, mm-hmm. I think can it make us look closer to 6%. I mean, mm-hmm. if that happens, one of them is mining. Mm-hmm. And the second is the government's willingness to push the projects, clear the projects. I think they have to speed up that process and the projects have to hit the ground.
And last question, perhaps, inflation. Right, and that's something that's in some ways going to affect the electoral outcomes as well, because if people have been affected by inflation badly, then they're quite likely to express their feelings yeah. at the voting booth.
My sense is I think food inflation should moderate because one of the irritants have been vegetables. Vegetables mm. inflation has already started coming down and it will come down more sharply by the month of January. Mm-hmm. But I think the cereal inflation, which is rather inexplicable, I mean high cereal inflation because you have so much of food grain stocks, I think if one factor that will play out is that you will have better production, rabi production, mm-hmm. so that should dampen the prices. The second factor that is going to play out if government acts proactively, if it releases some of the food grains which are most of the time
rotting.
People are rotting. If they release it, I think that's going to be a big dampener.
Right.
So that can curb food inflation. But let me give you a bit of good news on the inflation front also. I think if you split the inflation, if you'll notice that edible oils, mm. pulses, and sugar, I think all three of them have deflation. These are, I mean, large consumption items. Everybody consumes them. I think, but the good news on this front has been overshadowed by the steep rise in vegetable prices.
Right, and we've run out of time completely. Thank you very much for speaking with us, Mr. Joshi. That's all we have time for on Policy Watch this episode. Thanks for watching.